Hey everyone, welcome back to Chipstock Investor. It's earnings season again, and we are starting off with ASML. But before we get started, quick word from the sponsor of today's video, Fiscal.ai.
Fiscal.ai is a fantastic platform to get in-depth analysis, especially on highly technical, complex companies like ASML. You can visualize and chart out financials with Fiscal's charting tool. There is the built-in AI chatbot feature to help you parse through things like earnings call transcripts and presentations. And there are custom tools that help you break down key performance indicators or KPIs for companies like ASML. We'll talk about that later today when we're discussing ASML's EUV, extreme ultraviolet equipment, both the now a little bit older low NA EUV machines and the new ones that everybody likes to talk about, the high NA EUV machines. Check it out.
You can get 15% off any paid plan with the link in our video description or here on the screen, fiscal.ai/CSI. And with that, let's talk about ASML.
And please remember, if you will, limit yourself to one question and one question only to give others the opportunity to ask their questions if they'd like.
I have two questions in six parts.
If you listen to the ASML earnings call, it was a doozy with the analysts.
They're pretty funny. Okay, so we'll start from the top. Semiconductor industry flow. ASML fits into that wafer fab packaging and assembly equipment portion of the industry flow. ASML is the biggest of the Fab Five. They're at the top. And where do they fit into actually manufacturing semiconductor chips? They primarily fit into that lithography portion. That's that center process that gets repeated over and over again.
Oftentimes, this is dozens and dozens of steps. Deposition, litho, etch, clean. Rinse and repeat over and over again as those layers of the wafer, the actual wafer, before it gets diced up into chips, layers are built up. They subtract some of those layers, portions of those layers, to create tiny little microscopic features to create some sort of chip, some sort of ingredient in a computing or electronics device. And lithography is obviously a key part of that. And ASML is important because they're one of the only lithography companies. And a lot of people say they're a monopoly. It's not actually a monopoly. There are other lithography providers, but they are the only ones that have extreme ultraviolet lithography machines because they hold the patents on that technology. They developed it over the course of several decades. So not exactly a monopoly. It's just that they're the only ones with EUV, the highest, most advanced lithography equipment.
But we've been focusing on this U-shaped recovery quite a bit for quite some time now. But we're expecting that the second half of 2025 will be coming out on the other side of that, for all of the other end markets related to everything except accelerated compute and AI. And of course, we know that there may be some headwinds in regards to this because of the tariffs and trade wars that will no doubt have some effect on this. But ultimately, chips have to get made because end markets need semiconductors. And so those sales will have to get made at some point, whether or not tariffs affect them.
Yeah, if inventories are too low, chips will get sold. Let's get to the specific Q2 2025 slides from ASML. And so we always start with the income statement. ASML has a nice, easy to read slide here, but let's break this down. So total sales, $7.7 billion. Net system sales, that's the actual sale of the lithography equipment, mostly lithography equipment. And then installed base management, this is the services and recurring revenue portion for ASML. And pretty much all companies that sell fab equipment have some sort of installed base or services sales segment. So we're going to come back to this here in a moment because there's an important data point within that line specifically that we have highlighted. Earnings per share, third to the last line, €5.90. So this was actually overall a pretty good Q2. Most of these line items, ASML exceeded expectations. So that's good.
Next place we go is to the consolidated statements of cash flows. Let's talk about that.
What we do here is we want to reconcile, in this case, GAAP net income with the non-GAAP or non-IFRS figures. And so there in the top left, highlighted in yellow, is net income. We have both Q1 and Q2 2025 highlighted. So GAAP net income, mostly flat quarter over quarter, nice improvement year over year. You can see from Q2 2025 compared to Q2 2024, nice sizable increase in net income. But if you continue on down there on an operating basis, when you subtract all of those non-cash items, Q1 and Q2 were pretty lumpy to start the year. This is actually pretty normal for ASML. This is a manufacturing business. They manufacture these machines in-house, and that can cause some lumpiness in actual free cash flow and operating cash flow and free cash flow. And also customer activity can cause some lumpiness here as well. What we do know is in Q3 and especially in Q4, we'll show you here in a moment, expect to see a big uptick in revenue and free cash flow as well. To calculate free cash flow, which we have not done yet, but it's pretty easy, you just take the middle yellow highlight, net cash provided by or used in operating activities, so 747.7 million in Q2, and subtract purchase of property, plant, and equipment of 414.8 million. So quick math here, we're looking at 330 million in free cash flow in Q2. And that's obviously a big increase over the last quarter where they had negative free cash flow. But this is a lumpy metric, but an important metric because it's cash that goes into the coffers of the business and thus benefits you or can be used to benefit you, the shareholder, which brings us to the pink highlights.
Yeah, let me ask you about that. So they had some dividends paid, and then they've also repurchased some stock, which they've been criticized in the past for not timing that very well. How did they do this time?
Yeah. So in the past, ASML has bought back stock whenever they just kind of had the cash on hand to do so. They weren't very strategic about it. But you can see from that stock chart here on this slide, they didn't do much in the way of stock repurchases last year at all. But then they resumed in earnest in Q1 and Q2 2025 when the stock price was down. And so you can see that that second highlighted line in pink on the right, nearly $2.6 billion worth of stock repurchased in Q1 and nearly $1.5 billion repurchased this quarter. They didn't repurchase hardly any the same quarter last year and in the second half of 2024 at all. This is fantastic. ASML taking advantage of a lower stock price and buying back more stock strategically. That's a good thing for a cyclical business, an industrialist like this. We like to see them get strategic with their repurchases versus just paying a quarterly or a semi-annual dividend, which typically happens just no matter what. Okay, balance sheet. Pretty simple on this one. Just one line item that we have highlighted here, and it pairs with the stock buybacks. $7.2 billion in cash and equivalents. You can see that's down from Q1 when cash was over 9 billion euro and down from 12.7 billion euro at the end of 2024. And most of that is due to the stock buybacks. Okay, so let's now talk about what happened in the quarter that caused these financial results that we just looked at. First thing here, Q1 and Q2 revenue breakdown. Let's start with the two pie charts on the left, Casey. Tell us about EUV versus the rest of the alphabet soup going on in the rest of the pie chart. You love acronyms.
I do love acronyms. So Q1, 5.7 billion in sales, now nearly 5.6 billion. EUV makes up in this most recent quarter, 48%, last quarter about 56%. And then their immersion systems making up the majority of the other portion of the business, and then logic equipment making up the vast majority of their end use cases, 69% in this most recent quarter. For memory, 31%.
And the uptick in logic sales would be Taiwan in the far right pie chart. You can see Taiwan sales to Taiwan, TSMC, increasing to 35% of revenue. Casey, this is something we talked about here last year and earlier this year, because there was a lot of worry about those sales to China, still 27% of total revenue. And that's obviously down from the elevated sales to China last year and the year before. This is worth repeating again, because a lot of investors sat on the sidelines when the stock prices dipped late last year and the first half of this year, worrying that somehow sales to China were going to deteriorate down to zero. And remember, the sales were elevated in the first place because of the backlog from during the pandemic. And so ASML and the other Fab Five have caught up with that backlog, and sales to China will gradually come back in line with basically where China is at overall in the global marketplace for chip production, which is, let's call it, around 20%. So for now, it's going to remain a little bit elevated over 25%, but we'll see it continue to gradually revert back to around that 20% mark. And that's nothing to panic about. This is just normal industry cyclicality. Taiwan and the US, maybe even South Korea and Japan, can help pick up that slack over time. And that's exactly what has played out this year. It's okay to see a single geography reduce as a percentage of total revenue. It's actually quite normal. I said we'd come back here to the installed base management, the services portion of the business. Over $4 billion, this is on the bar all the way on the far right. This is the first half of 2025, already at 4.1 billion euro in installed base services sales compared to 6.5 billion euro last year, on track to be a major record for this segment at ASML. This is not the sale of equipment. This is primarily upgrades to existing machines that are in the field. And in particular, the NXE 3800E Extreme Ultraviolet machines. Let me show you what that looks like here. And this is another important point. In the top left, there's that twin scan NXE 3800E machine. ASML said they were upgrading in this last quarter and got a big increase in service sales. This is a low A, or numerical aperture EUV machine, low NA. This is like not the latest and greatest, most expensive piece of equipment, but it's still really, really advanced. There's only so many customers that use these things. TSMC, Samsung, Intel, SK Hynix, Micron, just a small handful of these companies. And in particular, the reason why we say this is probably TSMC that wanted these upgraded is, as you perhaps know, TSMC has been saying, we don't need high NA. We don't need the high NA EUV machines yet. This is still something a lot of investors like to focus on as being the driving force of ASML right now. It's not. These high NA EUV machines are very expensive. They're a very expensive science project for especially Intel and to a lesser extent, TSMC. And TSMC has been saying the cost of one of these twin scan EXE 5000 machines, which is now north of 300,000 euro each machine, the cost is too high. It doesn't warrant us making that big of an investment. But hey, ASML, if you can upgrade our existing 3800 machines, we'll take it. This is the driving force for ASML's financials right now, is the low NA EUV machine. It's not very sexy. It's not super exciting to talk about, but it is what matters the most right now to ASML's growth story now and probably for the next 3 to 5 years. The high NA machines are just not ready yet. And when they are, it's going to be possibly just TSMC and Intel, maybe Samsung, that will use those, maybe the memory chip makers later on, but right now it's the low NA stuff that matters.
And management keeps reiterating that on all of their earnings calls and all of their investor days, that this is a phased program. There's multiple phases, and they're still just in phase one of this, that's still in R&D phase, essentially. Here's the outlook for Q3. I expected net sales between 7.4 and 7.9 billion euros, gross margin between 50 and 52%. Fiscal year 2025, they expect sales growth of around 15%, gross margin of about 52%, but they didn't give exact guidance for fiscal year 2026.
And why would they? We still have half of 2025 left. Management did call out tariffs and geopolitical uncertainties as a major risk. And so they didn't want to say for sure that 2026 would be a for certain growth year. And it's become very obvious that a lot of Wall Street firms were penciling in more significant growth in 2026 and didn't like that commentary. But these are the facts. It's just simply too early to call yet. But here's the good news. The Q3 outlook for sales was flattish, let's call it flattish, with Q1 and Q2. However, this is also not new. ASML quarterly revenue tends to skew towards the second half of the year. And in fact, Q4 tends to be quite strong. You can see the bump in revenue in Q4 2022, sizable quarter over quarter increase there. 2023, Q4, sizable increase. Just 2 quarters ago, really big jump in revenue in Q4 of 2024. It's probably going to happen again this year. So we just need to be patient. And if you can develop patience as an investor while Wall Street goes nuts because of one single quarter's financial report and vague longer-term outlook for 2026, you will do quite well. It's a wider range, yes, that is true. But if you are trying to figure out a valuation on ASML, this is going to be a much more important picture. The shorter term guidance is going to be very noisy, but as long as management continues to say, hey, we're on track to fall within our range for 2030 expected revenue, we're going to be all right.
For more in-depth research, analysis, and all of our work, all of our articles, you can check out our membership Semiconductor Insider at chipstockinvestor.com. Link in the video description and here on the screen. We'll see you over there.